Pain is an undeniable part of a fallen world, and we live in a fallen world. So I want to talk about how pain, if we rightly manage it, you know, if we know how to handle pain in the right attitude, in the right way, we can use pain to propel us into our purpose. Come on. Are you hearing me? Because we always hear pain is bad. Pain is a bad thing. And yeah, it is a bad thing because it feels bad. It's not comfortable. It's not good. And God doesn't send it our way. But he's smart enough and wise enough and big enough to use it for our purposes. We have an adversary. Let me go there. We have an enemy, because the Bible clearly says, the Apostle Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 5 that your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking to see who he can devour. Okay, trying to see who he can eat up, basically. Devour is not a good word. So he's not just looking to paw you, you know. It's just an analogy, but he wants to devour you. So we have an enemy. There's an enemy of our soul. So the enemy tries to, what he tries to do is abort God's purpose by trying to either destroy us or distract us. Right? Now, I want you to understand, in the backdrop of all this, while we talk about the enemy, we want to remember the enemy is never so big that he can do anything to move us away or take us away from God's purposes unless we just let him. Okay? So no matter what, we want to keep that at the backdrop, that the cross is bigger, that God is victorious, Jesus has overcome, so we don't have to be afraid of the enemy, even though he hates us, because God loves us. By virtue of being loved by God, the enemy hates us, right? So let's not forget that's the backdrop, that Jesus is just an undefeatable king, you know, and we belong to him. But having said that, there is an enemy that comes to contend, and he would love to distract us. He would love to make us believe or deceive us into believing that the game is over. Right? And he would bring these things into our lives in attempt to make us to abort the purposes of God or to relinquish or give up the purposes of God. Okay? And we can either allow him to distract, allow the pain of situations and circumstances and problems to distract us, or we can use it to move into our purpose and destiny quicker, probably. The enemy, when he sees that there is a call of God or a purpose of God or a destiny over a person's life, he will purposely bring problems and situations to either destroy the person or distract the person out of God's assignment. Okay? Now watch Moses. So when it was time for Moses to be born, you know that it was already time for the Israelites to be delivered out of Egypt. Okay, they needed a deliverer. A leader was coming. It was all prophesied about. Now, what did Pharaoh do? He sends an edict or a rule that every male child should be killed. Now, watch this. That's a spirit of murder. It's from the devil. Okay? Now, the devil decides, oh, the deliverer is going to come. Let's kill all male children so that these Israelites will stay in Egypt forever. They'll be slaves here forever. They had a great destiny, actually, right? So all male children are being killed. And then in the midst of that, we know the story how Moses' mother hid him and then, you know, sent him in a little basket of reed. And who finds him? Pharaoh's daughter, right? Pharaoh planned to kill him. Pharaoh's daughter finds him. And then, long story short, we know Moses is growing up under the enemy's nose, eating his food, drinking his wine, learning his language, learning his strategies, all right? And then, obviously, we know he goes and he's a prince of Egypt, then he makes some mistakes, and it's all in the plan of God because he had to learn how to be a shepherd back there in the wilderness, 40 years. Fast forward, he comes, he rescues the children of Israel. He's the leader, right? And even in that, every little incident you can see, even the Red Sea, right? The enemy thought that, you know, they're trapped. Red Sea in the front and the army of Pharaoh at the back, they can't do anything. But God does the miracle, they pass by, then Pharaoh and his armies follow, And they all collapse and die. The water is back. So I'm really fast-forwarding it, but we know that the enemy wanted Moses dead right from the beginning. From the time he was born and then all the way through wanted. But God was able to use the tactics of the enemy. God was telling Pharaoh, oh, you want to kill him? I'm going to get him to come and live in your house and eat your food and then kill you, by the way. 40 years later, 80 years later, right? So God can do that. It happened in the life of Joseph. Joseph was destined to save an entire tribe, to save that nation from starvation when there was famine, which was yet to come. But God knew all that. See, the enemy saw destiny in him, saw the coat of many colors, got his own brothers to throw him in a pit, sold him off. And he was scrubbing floors in Potiphar's house. But God was planning strategically, okay, you need to be there, and then you need to be in this prison so that those two guys will be in this prison, and then you will interpret the dream, and then you will end up in the courts, in the palace. And so Joseph ends in the palace. And then through him, because of his brilliance, he is able to save not just his own family, but entire Egypt. Think about it. So the enemy wanted to destroy him. But God was strategizing through all that. Enemy put him in chains and took off his robe and had false accusation. All of that pain and trouble, God used it to make him the prime minister. And by the way, salvation of just one nation. More than one nation, because Israel was also saved through him. Right? So, and then we know that David, it's the same thing. We know he was rejected. You know, he was the youngest and he was out there in the back of the beyond sent to watch some sheep. Right? And then even when Samuel comes to anoint one of the boys, the father doesn't even think of calling him from watching sheep. Here are all the tall, handsome, good-looking, strong fellows. Here, one of them must be the king. That's super rejection. And then because the prophet said, Noah, is there not another person? Then the father says, oh yeah, by the way, there's my youngest, you know, he's just watching sheep. Get him over here. So not just father, not just his brothers, you know, we know his brothers rejected him, and not just his wife, not just Saul, whom he looked up to and served with a sincere heart, not just the people who he, you know, gathered and trained and brought up as an army. At one time, they all wanted to kill him. So he went through a lot of trouble, we know. He was, half the time he was running after being anointed by the prophet. Half his life he was running from enemies. But God had intended that he be king of Israel and a model king, and out of his lineage would come Jesus. And so when the enemy was trying to destroy him, God was enabling him to use that as stepping stones to be where God wanted him precisely to be. Think about even just the sword, you know, where we, you know, the David Goliath story. Yes, no? Okay, I like to know that you're there. You're tracking with me. All right. Now, David Goliath story, it says he went with the stone and the sling, right? And the Goliath came down with a stone. But he actually goes there and takes the sword of Goliath and cuts off his head. That's the actual story. That's how Goliath died. So the sword that was meant to kill David, yeah, the enemy must have thought, like, sharpen it today nicely and keep, we are getting that boy. Because Goliath prophesied, this day I'll cut you into pieces and feed you to the birds of the air. That was the intention. But the same sword killed Goliath. So we need to know that everything the enemy plans, he comes against us because he sees God's destiny over our lives. But God is greater than the enemy. Right? And now, mind you, all these people had to cooperate with God. They had to go through seasons of pain and trouble, and they would give their hearts over to God. They'll worship God and they'll say, God, and they will maintain their integrity through hard times and difficult times. See, David could have gotten back to Saul many times, but he didn't. He maintained. He said, no, I will not touch the Lord's anointed. He stayed. He maintained his integrity. All of them. Joseph, he could have slept with that lady. She was coming on to him. No one would have known. But he said, no, I won't do this, not just because of the master, but because God, who's unseen here, sees me. all of them maintained their integrity, and I'm not just talking about moral, you know, and ethical things, but in every way, they maintained, they learned from God. When they made mistakes too. They humbled themselves, they repented, but they always got back online. They came back, they always came and aligned themselves with God again. And the last example, Jesus, I want to talk. Now you realize that when Jesus was born, same thing happened. All the male children were being killed. Ha, the devil was trying it a second time. He knew the deliverer was coming. Let's try killing the male children, all the male children. But again, it didn't happen, right? God saved him. But then, I wanted to look at a verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7 and 8. This is talking about God's wisdom, God the Father's wisdom in sending Jesus, okay? So here's the verse, verse 7. No, we declare God's wisdom a mystery that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. So he's talking about God's wisdom as a mystery, okay? And God's wisdom was Jesus, right? And then he says, none of the rulers of this age understood it. They didn't understand what God's wisdom was, okay? For if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. They thought they nailed him, right? They put him on the cross. They thought, God, this man's been blaspheming. We got him. He's like, you know. And we keep him in the tomb and cover him with a big stone so that no one can ever say that he just. All of that stuff they did. But the thing is, that shameful death on the cross was precisely what worked out to be the salvation of the whole world. Now, if the people of those enemies of God and enemies of Jesus knew that would be, they would have never done it. So they were thinking, we got him. We'll nail him. We'll finish him. We'll bury him and we'll keep a stone so big no one can even come out. Come on. But God, always ahead of the enemy. All right? Now let's go to the next slide. 2 Timothy 1:9 says, he has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything that we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. So God has saved us and called us, not because of anything that we've done, not because we deserve it, not because we don't deserve it, nothing. It has nothing to do with us. He saved us by his own purpose, for his own purpose. And grace. So there's his purpose upon our lives and there's grace to do it, to fulfill it, right? And again, Psalm 139 verse 16 says, all the days that are ordained for me are written in your book before even one of them came to be. So we know that if we are here, if you are sucking air, you are here according to God's plan for his purpose. Come on, can you tap someone and say, we are here for God's purpose? I didn't see some of you doing it. We are here. This is a deep conviction. This is the truth of the word. This is the word of God. And we need to know it, say it, speak it, understand it, believe it, and live it. Amen. Through ups and through downs, through everything, we need to know this. When you are pregnant with purpose, and I don't want to gross you out with this term pregnant, because like what I'm saying is when you're carrying purpose in your life, you know, it's within you. You are a person of destiny, and you're carrying the purpose within you. You will be tormented until you give birth to it. When I say tormented, you know what I mean is either the enemy is going to spot that purpose and be coming at you till you quit or till you give or till he realizes that you are not going to stop, right? Or that destiny that you're carrying, that purpose that you're carrying is so real that you are just dissatisfied with life until you find that purpose. So there's a dissatisfaction. There's a frustration, a holy frustration. There's you're not satisfied. You're not content. You're just like there's something missing, something lacking, and you don't know what it is. But it's because you're carrying purpose, and you've not found your purpose. You're functioning outside of your purpose, and that is why that dissatisfaction is there. It's a torment in a good way. Because it'll bring us into the purpose. So there's a torment of purpose that I like to call it. And either way, whether it's the enemy or whether it's our dissatisfaction. And see, sometimes it's a combination. We are going through strife, we're going through struggle, we're going through hard hard times, and we are not where we know we want to be, because that's the desire that God has put. We know this is not what God has for us, and it's not happening. And it's you know, and so it's a real torment to be in that place, because we want to be where God is. And I just want to give an example, actually, from Hannah. Hannah was the mother of Samuel, the prophet, right? And everybody knows the story of Hannah. You can find it in 1 Samuel chapters 1 and 2. And chapter 2 is just her song of praise. But actually, in chapter 1, you'll find that Hannah comes into the scene at a time when Israel is politically corrupt, morally corrupt, and you know, in every way there is a decline. People did what they wanted to do. There was no order. There was no godly example. There was no word. There was no vision. There was no prophecies. Okay, and you'll find that in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verse 1, and then the last verse, you'll see. Altogether, it was a really bad time, not just politically, economically, also spiritually, because even the priests were not living the lives that they should live. They were living in sin and corruption. Okay, Eli was the priest at that time, and his son. He was a good man, but his sons were going haywire, right? So let's. So the story of Hannah in chapter 1, I'm just summarizing it because, you know, I don't want to take too much time. You can read it in 1 Samuel chapter 1. There was a man called Elkanah, all right? And he's the husband of Hannah. And this man, he was from the tribe of Ephraim, you know, from the hill country, but he had two wives. We are not going to go into the ethical things about the two wives. It was allowed those days. But anyways, let's stick with the story of Hannah. So Elkanah, all the men are like, what? We can't do this now? No. All right. Stay with me. So there was a man called Elkanah. He had two wives, Hannah and Peninnah. Okay? Now Hannah was the mother of Samuel. But the story doesn't start like that. Okay, it starts as Hannah, one of the two wives of Elkanah. Now, Peninnah, you know, I was thinking about it. Peninnah sounds like pain in the, I don't want to say it. Pain in the, I don't want to say it, you know. So Hannah and Peninnah, because she was a mean woman. The pain in the, I don't want to say it, was a mean woman, right? She had children, and she probably had definitely more than four, because the Bible says that her sons and her daughters, and definitely probably more than four. But it says Hannah was barren. She didn't have any children, right? Now Elkanah loved Hannah more. Now the story is getting really complicated here, right? But Peninnah is constantly mocking Hannah because she doesn't have children. And you have to understand that this was not only a personal thing for Hannah, but it also, in society, in that culture those days, it was a very shameful thing, right? So Peninnah is mocking Hannah constantly, and then Hannah's pain is unbearable. She has to bear social disgrace because of what the time that she was in. She has to bear personal emotional pain, mock it, and to add to all that, add fuel to the fire, was pain in the, I don't want to say it, was Peninnah always mocking her. The Bible says she would mock her all the time, right? And let's go to the next one. The sad thing about this whole thing, the really sad thing, is 1 Samuel chapter 5 and 6 says that it was God who had closed her womb. Twice, and verse 6 again. Because the Lord had closed her womb. So what do you do when the person who's supposed to be blessing you is the actual one who's actually restricting you? What do you do when the person who you know has the answer, and we know it's only God, right? What do you do when that person, you know, he can easily open a door for you? You know, he can easily make that thing go away. You know, he can easily heal you. You know, he can easily do it, but he is actually the one who seems to be restricting you from coming into that, from entering through that door, from coming into that blessing. What do you do? That is a very painful place to be.